He died for us on the cross. We thank you that He is the greatest gift that you ever gave to humanity. We thank you, O Lord, that if you speak, you shall be. Tonight we beg you that you may speak to each of us. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
I want to praise God for the privilege that we still have with them of coming together in this place. I want to once more thank the two small groups. How many here are from Lam? Can I see the hands of those who are from Lam? Is there anyone who wants to be here? Oh, praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Welcome, Lam. Just say welcome. Lam, welcome.
Welcome.
How you will come out? Huh? It's mine. Okay, okay. Lam, can you please stand up and then we will say, hi Lam, welcome. Okay. Can you say Lam to stand up?
Then we found out that the people had forsaken this.
But when you read about Hezekiah, this king brought Israel back, and he said, we're going to go back to the covenant. And they start doing the Passover, which is the first feast of the sanctuary. What's the first feast of the sanctuary? Passover. There were seven feasts, but the Passover is the first. The last is not the Day of Atonement. The last is the Feast of the Tabernacle. Now, we saw all these things. Now, we found out that God actually gave us this, and it was given since back then to Moses. And, you know, some people say, why do you have to go back to Moses? We don't need Moses. I talked to my very good friend. I cannot mention the name of the person. Very good friend of mine, and we talk about this, and they say, we don't need, this is what he told me, we don't need the sanctuary for us to understand the work of Jesus. I'm telling you, if you talk like that, I'm telling you, you are not Adventist. You are not Adventist. You are not Adventist. Now, let me show something in the book of John, John chapter 5, before we continue. Let's go to John chapter 5. John chapter 5 will tell us the reason why, my brother, we should have this book. Because it was because of the people left the book, which is called the book of the law. They forsake the book of the law. As a result, they went to horses. Many people think the book of the law was the ceremonial law. My friend, the book of the law was larger than the ceremonial law. The ceremonial law was there too, but the book of the law taught Israel how to eat, how to dress, the system of education, all the things that they should be doing was written in the book of the law. And the book of the law was not in the outer court. When Moses died, read the Deuteronomy, you see that the book of the law was in the most holy place with the law. Now, if I forsake the book of the law, say, who wrote the book of the law? Anyone know who wrote the book of the law? I wish I could tell you. Moses. Who is Moses? It's a prophet. That means the book of the law was the writing of God. You know, I can actually show you from the sanctuary, and I can tell you that Sister White is a type of Moses. It is a spirit that I'm talking about. Because the writing of Moses, but we don't have time tonight, was in a most holy place, but not inside of the Ark of the Covenant, but was beside of the Ark. There's something about Sister White very much. If you see, Moses was not an ordinary prophet. Moses was a special prophet. Because Moses was a prophet of the movement. Who brought Israel out of Egypt, going to the promised land. I can tell you from the Bible that Sister Moira is the prophet of the movement. And she, though she died, by her right, continue. Moses died, but he said, this is, if you read Deuteronomy says, he commanded the Levite that any time when they take the ark, they should also take the book of the law, wherever they go. So what brought apostles in Israel was when they rejected. Only one thing, whether you reject the law or the writing of the prophet, you're going to end up going to apostasy. If you reject the law, you will end up rejecting the writing of the prophet. If you reject the writing of the prophet, because all these have to go together. That's why no wonder when Jesus said, even in Isaiah 8 verse 20, the Bible says the law and the prophet. The law and the prophet. If you read, if they don't talk about this, they are lost. You go to Matthew, you just say, I didn't come to what? To destroy the law and the prophet. So the law and the prophet always go together. But we don't have time tonight to explain this. But we got to move to the book of John. John chapter 5. Let's read John chapter 5. Let me know by saying amen.
Amen.
John the chapter 5, the Bible says, verse 41. Now, I wish to tell you many things what Jesus was talking about here. But I just have to pick up verse 41. Let's read together. Jesus was talking to the Jews. He says, I do not what? I do not receive honor from men. I'm telling you, my Lord Jesus. We like when people lift us up. Oh wow, you are doing PhD. Oh, you are doing this and that. We love when people tell us such a thing like that. My brothers and sisters, this is unnecessary. Because we must have the honor from God rather than honor from men. That's why many people, because of that, they no longer know how to humble themselves. That's because they have said that they believe and they believe in sin. But a relationship with Jesus can save a man. Amen? Can save a man. The Bible says in verse 41, but I know you. Jesus said, I know you. What did he say? That ye have not what? The love of God where? In you. That's them. What the Bible say about the love of God? 1 John John 2, verse 15 to 17. What the Bible say? Do not love what? Neither the thing which are where? For if any man love the world, the love of the Father is nowhere. Didn't say it's not outside of him, he said it's not in him. So that means if these people, the love of God is not in them, what do you think, that, according to the verse that I read, what does it mean? They do not love God. They love the world as a result, the love of the Father is not in them. Now let's look in verse 43. I am coming the world in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. That's very interesting. Jesus came in the name of his Father, but he said, you have not received me. Now it's continued. If another shall come in his own name, you shall do what? This is what we do. You know, if a prophet will say something, they say, this is too old, gone. But if somebody is a PhD, they don't look up here, PhD in theology. Everyone will believe, everyone will embrace because it is a PhD, I'm telling you. We should not follow PhD. We should follow what the Bible says. We should not follow what he said, or what men say, or what evangelists say, whatever it is, but should follow what God says. As a result of following men, that's why today we have many churches. You know, there's no many reasons why we have many churches. There's no many. The reason is only one. It's mean the Bible is not directed. Because when the Bible is directed, we don't need many churches. If the Bible is directed, you will not see many churches. The reason of many churches is because people don't follow the Bible, follow men. Now Jesus said, you receive honor of other people, but I came in the name of my Father, you are not receiving. Let's continue, verse 5, 40, now please. Read very carefully verse 44. This is the verse that I'm going to show you. The Bible says, how can he what? Which what? What is this? How can he what? Believe in which honor of what? One of another. And what? Seek not the honor that comes from God. What's the next word? What's the next word? No, please tell me the next word. What's the next word?
Only.
You know what that means? That means Advent, we should not believe in any other thing, but only what God says. Amen? Because the Bible says, and seek not the honor that comes from God only. So we should not regard any other honor, but we should only say, is this what God wants? Is this what God says? Doesn't matter who is the man who says, but is that what God says? If any time that somebody comes out, we should question the person, is this what God says? What does says the Lord? Now move on. Verse 45. He says, 45, do not think that I will accuse you. My Father. There is another one that will accuse you, even Moses, that you trust. You know, the people trust Moses. Verse 46. For as ye believe Moses, ye will have what? Believe in me. For he wrote what? Please, let's read the last verse. The Bible says, but what, Jesus? He says, but if ye believe not in his writing, what the Bible say? How ye can believe in my word? Now, you know, when I was doing this, I was shocked. Because in other words, the Bible says, I know many people, how many of you like Matthew, John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the gospel? How many of you love the gospel? Tonight I'm going to tell you this. What Jesus is saying here, before you study the gospel, you got to study the book of Moses. Can you see that in the Bible?
Yeah.
Can you see that in the Bible?
Yeah.
Because it's saying, unless you believe what Moses wrote, then you will not believe in me. That's why we have a lot of power. That's why we forsake the sanctuary. This, there is a reason why today we don't talk about this. Who wrote about the sanctuary? Moses. Who talked about the sanctuary? Moses. Everyone who came after Moses, even though Moses died, but the people are supposed to follow the writing of Moses. People are supposed to follow the law and the book of the law that Moses gave. So Jesus says, if you don't believe in what is in his writing, how you can believe in me? Not what he says. If you don't stand what he says, you no longer also see me clearly. Now the sanctuary shows very clearly Jesus. The sanctuary will tell you what we're supposed to be doing right now. You know what we're supposed to be doing right now? tell you what man we are right now in the plan of redemption. The Son can tell you what you're supposed to eat. The Son can tell you what you're supposed to dress. Everything about seven-day Adventist is all here. The Son, that's why it's called the scripture which above all other has been what? Both the foundation. What is the foundation? The foundation is something that is based on the foundation, not necessarily the foundation, where? Central pillar of what? Catholic faith. Is that what he said there? He didn't say Catholic, he said Advent faith. That means, listen to me, when you don't know the sanctuary, you simply you are not Adventist. But praise God, we can be Adventist tonight. Yes, sir. And we can study this more, not just from here, from this week of prayer, or whether we are studying the Day of Atonement, but we can study more. Now, when you say central pillar, I don't remember in the Bible, I would have been saying. In other words, the man, his name is Samson. That's Judges chapter 16. Because of this carelessness, something happened to him. The enemy of God's people kept him and took his highway off. And they brought him to a place called Gans. That place is the stronghold of, if you read Hebrew, I mean, if you check even Hebrew, Gans is a stronghold of that of the Philistines. So that the reason, and you see, the Bible said they went down. I wonder why they went to a place which is down. Because maybe they know if you go to the mountain, for example, if Gans would be in the mountain, it's easy for the enemy to run and go down, right? Go somewhere else and then escape. But when you are down, it's hard for you to go up. They can catch you. And you don't know if around that mountain or that place or that area, there are other troops to control all the place. So they need, I don't come to tell you this, but if you read the Bible, you see that when they get Samson, he was very happy. They say the enemy of our people, the one who destroyed countries, no one can. Listen, some of you guys are really Samson, and because of not listening to what God is saying, we lose our strength. As a result, we are in the place of guns. And unless we do the prayer that Samson did, I'm telling you, you cannot leave that place, but that place is there. Now the Bible says Samson came there and he said, let's go. He was in the prison, he said, let's call Samson here to entertain us to give us sport. And they called him, they brought him, and Samson was giving sport. And after that, Samson asked the little boy, can you please send me, go with me to the pillar of this house? And the Bible says, there was not only one pillar. The Bible says there was two central, just like that, two central pillars. And I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters, Samson was not the devil, but the devil is acting like Samson. Because Samson, when he went there, the Bible says he hold those two pillars and he break down the house, everything. And the Bible says he killed more people that day since rather than any other time. So the devil, the only way that he can destroy Adventists is by removing this pillar out of us. You know, this is, for those people who are acquainted with our fundamental belief, this is in our fundamental belief. There's something. But, I don't know. There, it's only we that the sanctuary are above. That's it. My friend, you cannot understand the sanctuary above there unless you study the sanctuary which was the time. You must first study this sanctuary. The one on the earth, study what everything means. What is the gate? What is the label? What is the outer burner? What is the gate, the door of the tabernacle? What is the table, the candlestick, the table of showbread, the altar of incense? What is the ark? Study all this. When you come to understand, if your heart is open, then God will teach you a lot of things. The whole Bible is all about the plan of redemption. If you don't understand the plan of redemption, we got to study this sanctuary. Because Jesus' throne is in the most holy place. And when he left his throne, he came to die for us. Where he came is here. I'll just give you very quickly examples, okay? He came all the way here, went down here. Right now, I was listening even in Andrews, in our own school, there are people who no longer believe in the sanctuary in heaven. Are you aware of that? There are people who don't believe in the sanctuary in heaven. You know, listen, my brother and sister, we are not to follow men. If we want to follow Jesus, we are going to follow the Bible. Yeah. Any man can say many things, and he can even tell you, there is no such thing sanctuary in heaven, but the Bible in the book of Hebrews says there is a sanctuary in heaven. Read Hebrews 9. He will tell you that the same thing that was here is also here. Now, should I believe men or should I believe what you read in the Bible? Believe what you read in the Bible. There is a reason why many people are acting this way. It's not because people are bad, but the devil is attacking the church. He knows that if we let this, our central pillar be gone. I'm telling you, right now, almost I don't know how our build are looking like. But this is our fundamental belief too. Now, my brothers and sisters, listen carefully. When Jesus died here, the first thing that Jesus did is not to die when he came. What was the first thing that Jesus did when he came on earth? I mean, when he started his ministry. You get well? Baptized. So what that means, when Jesus left here, he came here. I wish to tell you this more deeply. I wish to tell you what happened to Israel when they left Egypt. Because what happened, if you look south, what happened to Israel when they left Egypt, even when they passed the sea. Remember, first I'm going to tell you first Jesus before I tell you about us. Jesus left here, came here. 1837. And then he moved here. And then he went to 1832. The same year that he died here is the same year that he entered here. And then from here, 1844, he moved in the Muslim world. But for us, if we want to follow Jesus there, yes, before even we get baptized, then we must learn to sacrifice. Before I get baptized, they told me you have to give up smoking, you cannot smoke. I never smoke. I'm just giving an example. Anyone who went to Adventist before, 50 years ago, not now, because right now people baptize in the same day, even though they don't know. That's why there are a lot of backsliding. But the Sabbath can tell us the principle of everything of our church is here in this sanctuary. First, before you get baptized, you must learn to sacrifice. You must learn to leave all, and then you enter. Then you move here, and then the struggle right now is to go in the most holy place. Now, we found out last night we studied that the most holy place is the place that Jesus being what? Jesus is right now. And we must look like who? Tell me, brothers and sisters. We must look like who? We must look like Jesus. We found out that we must look like Jesus. And unless we look like Jesus, we cannot make it. We saw that we must look like Jesus. How do we look like Jesus? We saw that for us to look like Jesus, we must reflect his inner heart. Right now, we don't look like Jesus. Now, and then, we need to know ourselves. We saw all this. Because if we don't know ourselves, we cannot see the beauty of Jesus. We saw this last night. Remember that? We saw that last night. We saw this. We saw this. Let me show this. We saw this. That when we don't know, because the most important thing is to know, to know ourselves. Or to know ourselves, yes. But if we don't know ourselves, I mean, if we don't see the difference between us and Jesus, then we don't know ourselves. Now tonight, what I want to show you is this one. We studied, we found out that God wants to bring us back where? But this can never happen unless we are in the most holy place with Jesus. Now, the question is, have you seen those people who are married? Have you ever seen people married? When they be like 5 years, you know what happened to them? Later on, they look like what? They look alike. So Jesus said, my people in the dead, that's why it's atonement, one with God. God wants us to be one as much we be with Jesus. The Bible says, by beholding, we become changed. Listen carefully. Some people, when you behold TV or Facebook, your face will look like Facebook. Anything that you spend time into that, you will think, you will reflect just like that. But if you behold Jesus and you want nothing else but to see Jesus, you're going to look like Jesus. The Bible says, let the mind that was in Jesus be also in you. Now, we saw all this, and we found out that God, we saw all this, and we cannot actually repeat it. We saw that there is a great word and a little time. And we found out that the little time and great word, the great word is that we must look like Jesus. And for us to look like Jesus, what we need to do? For us to look like Jesus, what we need to do, friends? For us to look like Jesus, we gotta go where? We gotta go into the sanctuary.
study this one. You see, negative 20. Chapter 23, let's read together verse 26. The Bible says in Leviticus chapter 23, verse 26. Now remember this, the only way that we can believe in Jesus is to study what? To study the books of Moses. Now, if we want to follow Jesus, we got to study this sanctuary. We got to study this. And if we study, then we will understand clearly who Jesus is. Leviticus, the 23, verse 26. Let me know by saying amen. Now the Bible says, and the Lord. Now I like this. You know, this is how God speaks to Moses. He said, and the Lord did what? Spake unto Moses, saying, also what day? On the 10th day of this 7th month, which is the day of atonement, there shall be what? Please let's read together. There shall be what? There shall be what? A day of atonement. Now, let's read this together. Shall be a day of atonement. What else? And it shall be what? It shall be a holy convocation unto you. And ye shall afflict your soul and what? Offer an offering made by what? And ye shall do how much work? In that same day. For if what? For it is a day of atonement to make atonement for us. That what he said? Atonement for you. And then he said, what else? Before the Lord, your God. Verse 29. For whosoever so it be, that shall do what? Not afflict in that same day, he shall be cut off of the among what? The people. Now, to cut off me to die. My Bible says, we don't have time to explain everything, but listen to this. Here in 27, there are four duties of the Day of Atonement that we are told to do. Let's read together. Let's read again. Also, on the 10th day of the 7th month, there shall be a Day of Atonement. Ye shall do what? What's the first thing? You shall have what? Holy convocation. Please, let's say it together. What else? Sorry? Okay, the first thing is holy convocation. Remember, God said, be ye holy. I don't have time to explain everything. And then the second is, afflict your soul. And then the other one is, offer. And then the other one is, do no more. You know, friends, all those four we can study even maybe a week, but I hope we can tomorrow or later on Sabbath explain this more deeply. This is the duty of the congregation. What happened then? Now, you already saw this. Okay, amen. Okay, then we found out that there is something that we need to do. The high priest in the Day of Atonement, what do you need to do? To cleanse us. From how much iniquity? How much iniquity? Our iniquity. All the iniquity of the children of Israel. We are the children of Israel. And how much of, what is it? Transgression. All their transgressions. How many of their sins? All their sins. Putting them upon which head? Which head? We found out that this head, who is the head? Who is the head? Who is this head? Is that the head? Is our head? Which head? This one, this head? This head, right? This head and this head. Now we saw, amen.
Now we saw him, even Paul himself say amen. Now people don't say amen. I don't know. Do you want the devil to die, yes or no?
Let me give you another chance.
Amen.
No, amen.
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 Now, but it's like the devil, you know, you are smiling, right? But the devil is afraid of this prophecy. This is the most powerful prophecy in the Bible. Because this prophecy of Genesis 3:15, this is the whole plan of redemption. State all things focused in this prophecy that God said. Because this is the complete crash of the head of Satan. And we saw this in Romans 2. We found out what does it mean. Now, I want to move a little bit more farther because we already saw all this. Now, remember this. How many duties are there?
Four.
Holy convocation, what else? Afflicting your soul, what else?
Offering,
do not what? Do not do what? Now we saw this, that the sins of all of us will be placed upon the head of Satan. We saw it from the Bible, yes or no?
Yes.
Revelation 20. Now, this is the study tonight. The duties of what? The duty of what? Of the Day of Atonement. Now, I didn't type it there, but it should be the duty of the congregation on the Day of Atonement. Listen carefully. The priests take our sins, cleanse us from all our unrighteousness, all our iniquity, transgression, and sin. But you know what, people? While the high priest is in sight of that most holy place over there, the congregation had to come around the sanctuary, pray and cry and afflict their soul, because that day is the Day of Atonement. And the Bible says, if somebody will not do that duty, which is the four that I just showed you, that person will be cut off from the congregation. No longer will pass. What does cut off mean? According to the Bible, cut off. Jesus was cut off in the middle of the week. What does it mean to cut off?
Die.
To be separated. No longer you belong to that family. Now, friend, you have to understand this. Everybody in this day to come and say, Lord, did my sin that I commit when I confess in the altar call, did you already forgive me? Everyone will remember his sin and say, Lord, please forgive me. Lord, please forgive me. That's the affliction of the soul. I wonder if you are doing this today. I wonder if the Seventh-day Adventist is doing it. I wonder if many people come to the United Prayer and really afflict their soul. Maybe not in their room, in their house, and wake up in the morning and say, Lord, please be merciful to me, because my sins, remember this, our sins, even though I forgive, and even though you ask for forgiveness to God, but our sins are there in heaven, in the very presence of God. I thought that when we ask for forgiveness, the sin is gone. No. When we ask for forgiveness, the sin, all of a sudden, the sin is gone from me, but the sin is actually in the presence of God. Now, unless Jesus cleansed the sanctuary, the sin will remain. But we found out Jesus cannot cleanse the sanctuary if there is no sin. Yes or no?
Yes.
Now, and if I will not give my sin to Jesus, he cannot cleanse the sanctuary. No sin is there. What are you going to cleanse? And if he cannot cleanse the sanctuary because there is no sin, no crush of the heaven. Now, it's so important. That's why, friend, listen to me. Understand this. Last time I said that many people think that Jesus, they think that we are waiting for Jesus. You know, we are the one. He is the one waiting for us. It's not Jesus waiting for us. Just think. Because Jesus is waiting for your sins, my sins, so that he can cleanse. Our sin must go before him. And he must take those sins out of the sanctuary, bring it to place it upon what head? The head of Satan, escape God. And he will be there for many years. And 1,000 years. If I will not give my sins, Jesus is still waiting. But remember this, there is a limit. And the limit, we saw already that the limit is the national Sunday law for 7-day Adventists. Not for everybody. For 7 days. Because those people right now will decide to go in the most holy place with Jesus and say, Lord, whatever is take, I'm going to do it. Bible says they will receive the Holy Spirit, which is called the letter line, and they will proclaim, which is called the loud cry, and the world, which is out there, will come to Jesus. But those people who are taking carelessly, do not give diligence to the duty, they will be cut off. Does the Bible say that? That they will cut off? There is a cutting off. That means there is a limit. There is a cutting off, brothers and sisters. Now, we saw this. We saw, okay, this is the thing. Listen carefully. Look at this. This is this is the earthly sanctuary. Understand this. To understand this, to understand the word. It says, through the sacrifice and offering, brought to the earthly sanctuary, the children of Israel went to what? All the merit of God. This one, I was reading something very amazing. I was reading the life of Hezekiah. Then I saw that they were so excited. They did a lot of sacrifice. They did a lot of things, but they didn't see Jesus. They saw, you know, actually, they saw Jesus. They saw Jesus by faith. When they saw a lamb die, the Bible, if you read the Bible, they say they were so happy and excited for that day. Now, I wonder if you're happy that Jesus died on the cross, and we need to hold on to the merit of the Savior to come. And I said, Jesus already came, and I said, in the wisdom of God, the particular of this world, we are given what? To us, we might what? By looking to them and understand. That means, if we look into the sanctuary, study the shroud, study everything about the sanctuary, we will not be confused like Babylon. We will understand the work of Jesus. Because right now, many people don't know the work of Jesus. The work of Jesus in the sanctuary right now is the cleanse. But our sin must go there. So the work of Jesus in the heavenly sanctuary. Now notice this. In the typical service, when the high priest do what? Enter in the most holy place. All Israel were required to gather where? And he says, and in the most solemn manner humble their soul before God, that they might what? Receive the pardon. That means if I don't humble myself, is there any pardon for my sin? No. Humble their soul before God that they might receive the pardon of their sins and to be an what? And not to be what? Cut off from what? The congregation. Now listen carefully. What does it mean required? All of us here, we are studying, right? I want to a little bit talk about the requirement. When you say requirement, it's something that you have to do. If you not do it, what's going to happen? Can you pass the subject for the class? No. You will fail. Now it says, all Israel are required to gather by the sanctuary. Do you think? Which one is more important? The time or the until time? Why not? Which one is important? The sanctuary of Moses? This one? Or the original one? Now, Jesus says, he said, if all Israel are required, he said, how much more? He didn't say how much. He says, how much what? Essential. That means when you say essential, it's life. Life for them. It says, how much more essential in this antitypical day of atonement? That we, number one, understand the word of our high priest. Now, did we study this last night? The word of the high priest. Did we study? We studied. What's the word of Jesus? Takes it, claims the sanctuary. But remember this, Jesus cannot just claim the sanctuary because they can't restrict the leader of it. The devil will show where they didn't commit sin. The heart, they didn't commit sin. There is no anything that are commits sin. Who commits sin is us. So that means what Jesus needs to do, he cannot just cleanse the sanctuary above there, but he must also cleanse this world. He must cleanse us from our heart. He must cleanse us from all our selfishness and pride and all this that we have. And we need to ask, Lord, please, don't just cleanse it. Cleanse us from our heart. Because if our heart are not cleansed, we cannot see God. He says that we have to understand how much more essential are in this day of atonement that we are to understand the work of the high priest. What is the next word? Second is to know what duties are required for us. So there are duties for us to do, brothers and sisters, and we should understand it. We should understand it. The great word. It says, let's read this. It is those who by faith, only those who what? Follow Jesus' heart. The great work of the atonement. That means if I'm not follow, I'll be lost. Remember the 144,000? When Jesus was in the outer court, they were there.
And when Jesus moved in a holy place, they moved there. When Jesus moved in a most holy place, they also moved there. The Bible says they followed the Lamb wherever what he goes, and as a result, they look like Jesus. Now it says, only those who by faith follow Jesus in a great work of atonement who receive the benefits of God. So I mean, if I will not follow him by faith, I will not receive the benefit of this forgiveness. You know, right now, Jesus is waiting for you. You know, Jesus is loving. Jesus is waiting for us. He's waiting that we must give on. And first, we need to understand what is the word of Jesus and what is our part. And when we understand this, we must now do it in the way that, because we cannot do things without understanding. And God cannot condemn you if you don't understand. You must understand. But God can condemn us if he gives us the Bible to study and we are not studying. Now, we need to understand so we can have the benefit. Because Jesus wants to cleanse us, brothers and sisters. Remember this. We started last night. Step to God said, if a sinner would we take to heaven in the condition that it is, without first being changed, you deserve to come back. Because heaven will be a torture to him. That's why God wants to live with you forever. Can you see this, brothers and sisters? He wants to live with us, but we cannot go in the condition that we are. Right now, we embrace the world 100%. Everything about the world, we embrace it. How God can take you when you are engaged in a Hollywood movie and production, things like that? How can God take you if your song is not like Isaiah? Isaiah chapter 12. Have you ever read Isaiah chapter 12? Isaiah chapter 12, he says, the Lord is my song. Now, we embrace the worldly things. God said, no, I must first clean up all this before I take you with me. Now, he says the Jews, as we read, mediation of what? In their heart. While those who reject, notice, those who reject the light, which is what? Bring to view in this word, which word? Which word? The word of atonement. Those who reject this word, what happened to them? Are not benefited. What? Thereby. That's good news. So if you not go with Jesus in the most holy place, something will happen to us. We'll be cut off. And I say the Jews who rejected the light given where? At Christ's first advent and refused to believe on him as a Savior. You know, when you go in the sanctuary, you see Jesus. They reject Jesus as a Savior. What happened to them? The Savior of the world could not receive what? Pardon through him. So if you only Jesus can forgive. So if you're not going to Jesus, we are lost. He said, when Jesus at his ascension entered where? By his own blood into the heavenly sanctuary to shed upon what? He discipled the blessing of what? You know, there is a blessing, brothers and sisters. The blessing of the mediation of Jesus. The Jews, what happened then? Were left out. Moral darkness to continue their useless what? I wonder if they're really useless sacrifice. Because unless we go, you know, everybody who is in our talk right now, last night I told you, many churches right now, they don't know about the most holy place. They only know the outer court where Jesus died. They say, oh, Jesus died. And most people only want what? The death of Jesus for crime. But they don't want anything called the power to overcome sin. Okay, our time is running out already. But notice this. The administration of the time. Okay. The administration of the time. What's the next word for time? What is the other word for time? Sharp. SC. The door by which man has what? Formerly found access to God was no longer what? So in other words, the door from the outer court of the holy place was closed. But God opened one door in 1844. That door is called the most holy place. The Jews has what? Refused to seek him in the only one. In the only way whereby what? He could then what? Be found. Through the administration of what? The sanctuary had. Therefore, they found no one communion with God. To them, the door was what? They had no one knowledge of, you know, they went then, no knowledge of Christ, as the true
sacrifice and the only one, mediator before God. Hence, they could not what? Receive the benefit of the muscle of faith. We found out that there is progression for only 7 day advantages. Let's see what is the progression. It says here, they are what? Many who has not what? Yet heard this testing too for this time. There are many with whom the Spirit of God is doing what? Striking. The time of God's destructive judgment. Israel, when talking about judgment, is talking about the day of atonement. It says, the time of what? Destructive judgment is the time of what? Mercy. Not for adventists, but for those who are. Have had no what? Opportunity to learn what this one. Yes. Now we are learning this. So we have opportunity. Let's say, heavenly, will the Lord look upon them and his heart will be what? Of mercy. Is what? Touch. And his hand will be what? Straight out to save. Why? Read the next word. The door is closed to those who what? Would enter. Now, as we, as Adventists, do we have opportunity to enter right now? Where Jesus is? Yes or no? So by the passing of National Sunday Law, brothers and sisters, there is something that will happen that we will no longer go into the most holy place with Jesus. It's over. But so I say, no, no, how long, how soon that thing will happen. Right now we're being judged. The judgment start when Jesus entered the most holy place in 1844. He start with the dead, start judging the dead. Who is the first man that Jesus judged on the first day on 1844? Or 23, because his name was Abel. It was Abel who was the first man who was that God created. But God didn't start judge everyone at that point and do things. I wonder if right now we are being judged. Now, my brothers and sisters, we gotta go there. Because the devil is seeking to what? Gradually wrote this message. What is the message? Of the day of. The devil is seeking what? But Satan has been what? Seeking gradually to what? To rob this message of its power so that the people may not be what? Prepared to stand. How we can prepare to stand? Anyone know? For us to stand, we gotta go with Jesus. Because when Michael stand up, his people might stand up. Remember this? When Jesus stood up, the 144,000 stood up. Everywhere Jesus moved, they moved. This is the experience that we need to have. Unless we get this experience, brothers and sisters, we cannot make it. We cannot make it. Now, we saw, notice this. Many people, everyone know what is this, right? Huh? Everyone know what is this? You know who is this man? You know who is this man? This is what he said. What he said? You know, Trump came on time. This president came on time. Everything right now, you know, Trump was not about to be a president. Are you aware of that? Every person from the US know that, right? He was not about, he actually doesn't even agree to be a president. He didn't do anything for about political things to let this thing live. But he said here, he became a president. Because Ben Carson didn't want it because he's Adventist. You should know this. That something happened that because Ben Carson said many things about the Pope, about the Catholic Church and all this, and they found out that this man cannot help us. We need someone else. All the evangelical pastors are all together with this man. But the agency of evil are combined their force and on what? Consolidated. They are strengthened for what? For the last great crisis. Great changes are soon to take place in our world. My friends, while Jesus is about to leave the most holy place, many things going on right now in the church, outside of the church, and also where? Where? In the world. Right now, there are things that is going. He says, the prophet says, the agency of evil are combining.
if you are far away, the Pope is meeting, you will be amazed. This Pope could go to places that no other Pope went. This Pope could convince and make Israel, even right now, to have Sunday off. They have Sunday off right now. They no longer work on Sunday. Sunday they rest. They stay at home, they play sport and all this. But my brothers and sisters, honestly, I cannot really show you everything right now, but this is the thing. Notice this. This is by the decree enforced. The reason why we need to go to the most holy place with Jesus is because everything in the world right now is prepared for the crisis. But we aren't in this 100%. And I told you last night and night before, if you are waiting for your dad or anybody else to wake up so that you can wake up, that time will never come. If you are waiting for your pastor to stand up in the pulpit and to tell you, oh, now, brothers and sisters, this is the time to wake up, the National Assembly will pass, do this and this. If you are waiting for the Pope to tell you, do you think the Pope will tell you that about the National Assembly? Now, how near we are to the National Assembly? Because it says the decree enforced, the National Assembly will be enforced. It will not be something that will ask you to do. They will enforce you to obey. I'll read this thing next time. Now, there is National Sunday law, but there is also something else. Do you think same-sex marriage is something, is a prophetic thing? This happened in 2014. Do you think this that happened that year, when Barack Obama said, from now on, everyone, and the whole state is like the whole, though some other state, they deny, they say, no, we don't want this, but right now, those who deny before, right now, they're also embracing same-sex marriage. The National Sunday Law will be enforced. Because this is from the papacy. This says here, this is the institution of the papacy. In violation of what? The law of God. How they will do that? They will violate the law of God. They will disregard everything. When the Protestantism shall what? Right now, I wish to show you the thing. The Protestant world embraced. You know the man who is the man in there? Can you please tell me? Can I what? Kenneth Cowan. This man is the most powerful man who preached in the U.S. You know that man? Kenneth. I also show the video. This man has a thousand of members. But you know what happened? This man, he says, we no longer have to divide. We have to be one with one. With the Catholic people. But it says, National Sunday law will be the Bible says National Sunday law will be the last sin. But before that, there is this sin. Do you think this sin? This is sin. This is a counterfeit word, marriage. Now, this word is saying, borders approve what? Same-sex marriage. I don't have to go to. This is what for the first, never happened in the history of America. For the first time. Now, some people know who this one, right? Do you think this is a man or a lady? Did you watch the video? I'm sorry, but you don't know. But anyway, this same-sex marriage came on time. Why it came? It's hard to overstate what happened. But it says supported being given where for that. In U.S. in the year of 19, never, no one heard somebody opposed to them, or they say anyone close to them as what? Gay. But 2010, the number of that what? Lesbian what? Increased. What number? 49. But this year, what the year that they proclaimed it, the number went to 60. You know, when it's going to 60, the number must come 100% for the National Sunday Law pass. Because there is a relationship. Do you think there is a relationship between National Sunday Law and the what? And the same-sex marriage? Do you think so? Let me show you. This is Obama says, gays married does not work. He strengthened the family. That's not true. It's a lie. But that said that, there's two marriages, two sons, two institutions. This is written from what book? Adventist Home. Have you ever read that? It says they are twin institutions. So if they are twin, it says the marriage and the Sabbath is what? They are always. Twin institutions for the glory of God. In the benefit of humanity. Then as the creator joined what? The hand of the Holy Prayer, saying, man shall leave his father and mother to what? Into his wife, and they shall be one. He what? enunciate the law of marriage for all the children of God to what and you what not. And you what end of the time. That means marriage is should be until the end of the time. But the people today they are saying no, we need something like this. Counterfeit marriage, counterfeit son. Right now, they already approved this one. Now, how many people are married here? We already we're done. How many people are twin here? Anyone in twin here? Have you ever seen a twin people? Twin people when they born, how long when the first come out, how long is it take for the other to come? 2 days? How many? 7 minutes? Oh, sorry? Second, right? Some people say second. It's the pain? So, tell me how many things is it?
Depends. Because yeah, adults look like adults don't look like some. They take wrong. Those guys.
No, but we're talking about twins.
Yes.
Yes.
This too.
When they are born, how long? When they first come out, the second, how long is it take for him to come out? Minute. So if they attack the marriage, what do you think? Don't you think we are very close? What is this?
If ever there is a time that we need to give our life to God, it's tonight.
We need to say, Lord, it is the day of atonement that I have to be one with you. And I see that this twin institution, this, you know, they attack this one. In U.S. again, they will proclaim this to be as a national goal. And Philippines will be the first country in the world. Remember, when they proclaim about this one, in the same day, every gangs in the Philippines jump on TV, I can see everything. You know why Philippines will be the first country to do that? Because Philippines, they love America. And as a result, when the national Sunday law will pass, the Filipinos will be the first to embrace. Right now, they strengthen their relationship. Donald Trump came here, and now they are friends. And they are actually enjoying a good fellowship. And it's very interesting. This man, when he came here, started cursing each other with Duterte. They didn't have a good conversation, but right now everything is okay. Now, brothers and sisters, let's pray. I want to invite you, we'll pray and ask the Lord, Lord, do something in my life. Please, pray this prayer, Lord, wherever is my life, because it's, we're going to take a lot for us to do this. Now, tomorrow, we are going to connect the three angels' message into the Day of Atonement, okay? In the Day of Atonement, we are going to see what is God want to teach us with the three angels' message in the Day of Atonement, tomorrow and also tomorrow, upcoming on Saturday. Let us pray together. Let's pray. Let's pray. Father, we want to thank you. For we see the sign and we see that everything is here, Lord. But we are not ready. Lord, I beg you, I'm so weak and feeble. Lord, that perhaps I don't even have that strength and the power, Lord, to present this word as it's supposed to be. I plead, Lord, that may you bless each of us, that we may see this and may desire to have a deep relationship with Jesus. To know you, Lord, such as we have never before known you. Open up our hearts and minds. We thank you for loving us and for showing us this and for giving us this time. Help us that from now on we will not spend time on TV and something else, but we spend time with Jesus. We thank you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you very much, friends.